Hi, John here and welcome. Get straight into it. This is our solar stats home energy performance for March 2023 on screen at the moment, and also in the description down below is all the details of our setup. Let's start with our Ripple wind turbine at Craig Faffa. Here it is in Wales. We have 1,532 watts, which meets 34% of our electricity. In March, for the whole of March, we had £82.32 savings against our electricity bill, which is credited straight to our Octopus Energy account. This is the day by day, if you're interested, in a tabular format. There are a couple of days, or 3 days in fact, where the wind turbine was out due to hydraulic issues, but they've been sorted, and you can see they've lost a little bit of generation, but nothing horrendous. The interesting thing is from March is that we're now on 27 pence per kilowatt hour rate savings, as opposed to 9 pence from year one, so three times the amount of savings. And this is the same data set, but in graph format, showing day by day. This is the month by month so far since go live in March of last year. As you can see, the major spike there is purely down to the savings of 27 pence versus 9 pence by and large. But still, there's been some records broken, which is good with the amount of generation. We also have Kirk Hill, which is due to go live early next year. And we have more there, 75% of our needs. So in total, we have just over, well, just under 110% of our total electricity annual consumption covered by both of those wind farms. Pigeon update, very briefly. Pigeons are here and staying, but now staying away from our panels and collecting on everyone else's roofs, which is good. Another update, something like it took me like 5 minutes to do this. However, I don't know why I put it off. It's just one of those jobs you think, oh, it's going to be a real bit of pain, but actually it was very straightforward. And that is fitting the relay and sensor board into the Eddy, which I have had for about 18 months sitting on the shelf. You can get it straight from MyEnergy, link there on screen now. It's a relay board and a sensor board, and the benefit of that is that it allows you, there's two relays which you can use to control things when you have excess solar, in addition to heating your hot water, which is primarily what we use it for. But there's also the ability to add sensors. This is the box that's been sitting on the shelf for 18 months in the office. These are the instructions, a little board which sits on those four white plastic risers. And just take the cover off from the Eddy and just clip it in place, attach the ribbon. Job done. Very simple install. Took me, like say, 2 minutes to do it. And then I had a temperature probe, a PT1000 temperature probe, which I got off Amazon. And made a hole through our insulation in our tank towards the metal, poked the sensor end in. That's it. That's all you need to do, and it works straight away. And you can see here on the Eddy, it shows you the temperature. And in the app, if you fire up the app again, it shows you the same information with a bit of history tracked over there. And as you would expect, you can also drop it into Home Assistant as well, which is very straightforward. So as I say, it took probably half an hour from start to finish to do the whole thing. It took longer to go and get the tools than it actually did to install the board, the relay board, and the sensor. So I would highly recommend that if you haven't done that already. It's really useful from that perspective, let alone the ability to then trigger the two relays to like turn on underfloor electric heating or something like that, or whatever you've got it wired to. We also had our first quarter FIT payments covering January, February and March. That's £370.39, which as you can see there is the highest one so far over the years. And I had to chase EDF up, who do our FIT payments, because it had triggered their manual review because we've gone over the threshold of what was deemed as acceptable figure. And that's really because of the very sunny February. And this is how we are to date over the years in tabular format. So as you see there, we average about £2,200 a year in FIT payments, and that's again over 25 years. In terms of solar generation, we did 448 units across the two arrays, just slightly beating February. March, as you'll see in a little while, wasn't really great for us, as it wasn't for lots of other people. Normally in March, it's a lot higher. If you look at last year's March, it was 647 units. And in 2021, which is still quite poor, it's 473 units. So it was a very poor March for us. And the average units per day, as you can see, a drop from 15 in February to 14 in March. So that just sort of underlines how poor that was, even with extra days in the month of March and longer hours of daylight for potential solar production, still less on an average daily rate. This is the split between the two arrays. So 153 for the 2.34 array and 295 units for the 4 kilowatt array. And this is the Solis inverter. I don't normally include this, but I'll just do a screenshot as it's the second month that it's been used. So it's the whole of March. And what I was interested in is looking at the full load. So 65 hours out of the month for a full load. So that means that the inverter was at maximum capacity. It's a 2 kilowatt inverter, but it runs about 2.10 as a max. So it's slightly overclocked, if you like. This is our self-power between solar and the power wall. Green represents the power wall, the battery, making a self-power, and yellow is our solar panels. So 65% self-power for the month. And this is the Tesla Powerwall app, which is interesting because it's only showing 61% there, but so what is it, 28 and 33. The figures for the previous chart are taken from the Tesla Powerwall app. So it does sometimes have a tendency to change itself slightly, but anyway, it's what it says. These are our solar start and solar end days and time. So this is the solar start and solar end for the whole of March. The bottom set of figures in the darker colour is the start of the solar day, and then the red colours at the top of the chart are the end of the solar day. And you can see the slow increase in duration of days over the course of the month in terms of the amount of available sunlight or opportunities for solar production as the daylight increases. And then this is the peak generation in watt hours and the time of day that occurred, which is the blue line running across the middle. So peaks running quite good actually, 6,000 watts or 6 kilowatts, 6.2. Some poor days on the 9th for 500 watts, and one or two others there on the 8th as well. So fairly consistent, but a few poor days to bring down the overall total. So this is our year on year for March, since March 2012, and you can see there how poor by comparison. So March 2020 onwards would have been for both arrays, whereas previously it would have just been the single 4 kilowatt array. But you can see there, March 2020 zonking out at 695 units, a poor March in 2021, but even poorer March 2023. So it just sort of puts into perspective how poor March was for us. So how did everyone else get on in terms of their solar production? As ever, drop your totals down below in the comments, as I really like to see them and comment on them. So thank you for doing that in advance. On to the Powerwall in and out and its round trip efficiency. So 88% round trip efficiency, 402 units in, 355 out. This is the day by day for the month of March. Blue is house usage, yellow is solar input, import from the grid is in red, and export in orange. Not much export, as you'll see in a minute. We actually managed to use all of the solar that we generated on site. And the reason for that is we don't have a rate for export, so we don't actually earn any money. We have the deemed export as part of our FIT, which is 50% of what we generate. But it doesn't matter whether we export or not, because it's a deemed export. Our 50% of our generation total, and it's not a great amount. So we would, if we exported a lot more consciously, it would be worth swapping to a proper export tariff and losing the deemed export. But at the moment, we use almost all everything that we generate. So until that situation changes, don't see the benefit for us for going for an export tariff. These are our totals. So house use just over a megawatt, so almost 1100 kilowatt hours. Solar 448, as you know. In from the grid 669, export 6 units. This is the Tesla Powerwall app, again showing the same data set for March. 43% offset there in terms of how much solar we produced versus what the house usage. And then this is the, again, month by month on the Tesla Powerwall app, looking at house usage first, then solar production, and then battery, and finally grid. So it's the same data set that you've just seen, it's just in a different format, which you might find visually interesting. A little tip, if you do use the Tesla Powerwall app on your phone, what I found this by chance actually, quite often when I scroll back through the days to look at, you know, historic usage, to get back to today, I always used to scroll back the same way day by day. It was a little bit tedious, but I did find that if you just double click up on the date, it then magically pops you back to today. This is our grid usage, our average house usage, and our average grid usage day by day over the course of the month. The blue line shows the average house usage in kilowatt hours or units. So that's 35, same as in February. From the grid, slightly less. Oh no, same. It looked as though it was less. 22 versus 22 in February. Sent to the grid, as you've already seen, 6 units. I guess they should really be in orange, this chart, to match the previous chart that I had on export. So perhaps I'll change that. And this is import from the grid, which should be in red. So again, I'll change that feature. 669 versus 612 in February. So I've used more power from the grid, mainly because there was less electricity from solar generated. This is the eddy, which heats our hot water. So in March, we diverted 47 units to heat our water. Running total of 98 for the year, and cumulative since installation in July 2021 of 1361. Cumulative savings of £97.26 based on our off-peak costs of 8.5 pence per unit of electricity. And onto the cars, this is the Eddy. No, this is the Zappy even, John. Zappy, Zappy, Zappy. 18% of our charge came from solar, 53 units there, 53.59. The remainder came from the grid, so 82% from the grid at 243, giving us a total of 296.64 units. This is the spreadsheet in a lot more detail. In terms of what went where, the Model 3 charged 222 units, 222, and the Zoe did 74. Month end for the Tesla is 31,800 miles, 1,193 covered during the month. Costs of home charging was £10.03. Zoe month end was 30,296, 241 miles during the month. Again, £10.03. I'll just split the charge costs equally between the two. In terms of public charging, we did 8 supercharging sessions on the Tesla, adding 234 units for zero cost. Come the 23rd of April, we will be paying for supercharging. costs will increase there if we continue to use superchargings as frequently as we have been. Zoe did no public charging, so there's your total costs there for running the cars. On to gas and electricity costs. Here's our rates for electric. So on the Go Faster tariff, which ends on 5th of August, and the standing charge is 44.48 pence, which includes VAT. Gas, we're on the gas tracker, which on average is 4.97 pence over the course of the month, and 27.22 standing charge. This is a quick snapshot of our electric usage over the course of the month. So this is the calendar month, 1st of March through to 31st. And similarly with gas over the same time period. You can see the gas is slowly starting to creep down. So this is our electricity bill. The bulk of our charging 600 units is at 7.86 pence per kilowatt hour. What comes out of £47, and 27 units were at the peak rate of 32.79, giving us an average of 8.93 over those 627 kilowatt hours. And on to gas. For some reason, we've got sort of split over two bits. I'm not really sure why. 5th of March to the 31st of March. And then 1st of April to the 4th of April, perhaps that's a tax year thing. That's our charges that have been charged. So £98.19 for gas. And then another £10.75 for those odd days. And the electricity was £72.61. Our Ripple savings there of £82.32. We've also had a referral reward, which came in on the 7th of April, which is a day after the bill was produced. So I'm not sure whether it's beyond this bill or the next bill. I've included it here anyway, but I'll make sure I don't double count it if it's also included in next month's bill. So there's our debits and credits, which brings us to £49.23 for the month, using 627 kilowatt hours or units of electricity and 1700 units of gas. So there you go, that's everything I think. Any questions, drop down below, I'll pick them up in the comments. Thank you for watching, I'll see you on the next video. Take care, bye.